have to remind people to say amen or to push them, but you all have already started us in such a good mood. So happy to see you all this morning. I saw one of the members patting his feet when the choir sang, and I said, you're going to have to get up and wave your hand a little bit, amen, because we're excited to be in the house of the Lord. And so we're so glad that you're here this morning. This is a day that the Lord has made. Let us rejoice and be glad in it. For those of you who are physically here, we're just excited to see you, and you all have to forgive the preachers, especially me. Sometimes when I get overly excited when I see you, as one of the members says, when we see you, one day we'll be able to hug, and we're just happy that you're physically here in the building. And those of you who are watching from home, we welcome you also this morning. We ask that you would check in if you would go to fumctupelo.com/I'm here and let us know that you're here. And if you're a visitor, let us know that you're a visitor. And we're very excited to have you worshiping with us today. Also, I'd like to share with you some of the things that are going on in the life of the church. Sunday school classes have resumed. Most of them are via Zoom. There are some that are being held in person at 10 o'clock every Sunday. There's also a men's Bible study that Smith leads every Wednesday morning for the men at 6 a.m., and we invite you to be a part of all of these activities, including our small groups. Also, Refresh has started back. David is teaching the Bible study Refresh on the Gospel of Matthew, and it meets via Zoom every Wednesday at 6 p.m., every Wednesday at 6 p.m. Also, we are excited, again, that we have persons who are able to worship with us in person at our 8:45 invitation service and 11 o'clock traditional service. We remind you that registration, however, must be made for those two indoor services. You may register Sunday beginning at 2 p.m., today beginning at 2 p.m., and registration concludes at noon on Thursday. We are excited that our numbers have been such this week that we actually numbered out, and so we'll be looking at perhaps expanding our in-person worship. But again, we remind you to register. Also, there's an outdoor service, and we remind you that we'll look to see how that will continue depending upon the weather and how the numbers go, but there is no registration required for the outdoor service at 11 o'clock. We are also very, very excited that Holy Week is coming, and you'll notice that we have the Monday-Thursday service, April the 1st, at 6 p.m. You must register in order to attend in person. However, it will be live streamed, and we invite you to participate in that. Our Good Friday service will be in the sanctuary in Wesley Hall at 7 o'clock, and we invite you to register for that if you anticipate being here in person. Also, you will note that there are a number of ways in which we anticipate celebrating Easter. There are too many to take time out to list them all now, but please look at the newsletter and you will see them there. The 6:30 sunrise service, there will be two 8:30 services, not 8:45 now, 8:30 services, a 10 o'clock service outside on the East Lawn, and 11 o'clock traditional service. And you must register for all of the indoor services. At this time, I would like to invite you now to turn in your Bibles to Psalm 107, 107, 1 through 3 and 17 through 22, as we prepare now for our worship through the reading of Scripture. Hear now these words from Psalm 107. Oh, give thanks to the Lord, for he is good, for his steadfast love endures forever. Let the redeemed of the Lord say so. Those he redeemed from trouble and gathered in from the lands, from the east and from the west and from the north and from the south. Some were sick through their sinful ways and because of their iniquities endured difficulties. They loathed any kind of food and they drew near to the gates of death. And then they cried to the Lord in their trouble, and he saved them from their distress. He sent out his word and healed them and delivered them from destruction. Let them thank the Lord for his steadfast love, for his wonderful works to humankind, and let them offer thanksgiving sacrifices and tell of his deeds with songs. This is the word of God for the people of God. Let us now bow our heads for prayer, please. Almighty and everlasting and ever-loving God, we thank you for this day. It's so beautiful on the outside, and we ask and pray that you would give us beauty also on the inside of our hearts, our souls, and our minds. Transform us, O God. We've already been uplifted through singing this morning. We've already been uplifted through the sharing of what's going on in the life of the church. We ask and pray, O God, that you would bless David as he prepares to come and to deliver your word to your people this day. And we ask and pray that we would not only hear the words with our ears, but also have them ingrained in our hearts, souls, and minds, so that when we leave this place of worship, we'll be determined to make the world a better place in which to live. On this anniversary of this nation, hearing the news and the first persons dying from the COVID, we ask and pray, dear God, that you would protect us from this virus. We ask special memory upon those whose lives have been lost. We ask and pray that you would be with their families. Be with those who still suffer from this virus. Bless and watch over our church. May we continually be a beacon of light in a world of darkness. And may we continually spread the good news of Jesus Christ wherever we go. We ask and pray, dear God, again, that our worship service would be uplifting today, so that we might be reminded that you are the Lord of all. Forgive our sins, uplift us, and allow us continually to spread the gospel of Jesus Christ wherever we might go. This we ask in thy name. Amen.
Well, good morning. Everybody, let's go ahead and stand. We're going to sing a song called The Lord's Prayer. And we've done it before, so we'll get used to it. It goes like this.
Not into temptation, but
sing with us.
Who the Son sets free, oh, is free indeed. I'm a child of God, yes, I am. Free at last, He has ransomed His great while I was a slave.
Children. Lord, you have set us free. You've made us into a people when we weren't a people. You've called us out. You've called us out as a special and chosen people. And you've called us to a place of work, a place of being engaged in your kingdom mission. So God, we ask that you continue now that transforming work that you have begun in each of us. Open up our hearts and our minds and help us to hear from you. Amen. You may be seated. Our passage of scripture this morning is from Ephesians chapter 2. We'll be looking at verses 1 through 10. Ephesians chapter 2, verses 1 through 10. Paul writes, "You were dead through the trespasses and sins in which you once lived, following the course of this world, following the ruler of the power of the air, the spirit that is now at work among those who are disobedient. All of us once lived among them in the passions of our flesh, following the desires of flesh and senses, and we were by nature children of wrath, just like everyone else. But God, who is rich in mercy, out of the great love with which He loved us, even when we were dead through our trespasses, made us alive together with Christ. By grace you have been saved, and raised us up with Him and seated us with Him in the heavenly places in Christ Jesus, so that in the ages to come He might show the immeasurable riches of His grace and kindness toward us in Christ Jesus. For by grace you have been saved, through faith. And this is not your own doing. It's the gift of God, not the result of works, so that no one may boast. For we are what he has made us, created in Christ Jesus for good works, which God prepared beforehand to be our way of life. This is the word of God for the people of God. Thanks be to God. Well, work looks a little different these days. As Embra mentioned, we're a year on into this pandemic, and for many of us, it has changed drastically. Now, for some of you, you've moved back into a position where it looks a lot like it did beforehand, except maybe the use of one of these, and maybe the use of, you know, personal space. Give me some room. It's changed. I mean, for us, well, for me, I've been working from home. I mean, you know, SPRC said it was okay. So, Tina, they said it was okay. That's what I'm going to do. I have a comfortable place. I have an iMac, and I can sit there and be in my home. And this is pretty much what work looks like for me. A Zoom call with my coffee. And, Embra, is it etiquette? Are you supposed to, like, turn the screen off when you take a big swig from your coffee, or are you supposed to just leave it up for everybody to see you going? Okay. I've been doing that wrong. But work for us is vitally important. I mean, if you didn't think that work was all that important, just let that work be taken away. Let us come to that place where we can no longer work. Let us come to that place where our work is very much inhibited. And then we start to realize how important our work really is. And I'm not saying that everything that we do has just this profound effect on the life of everyone around us, though for most of you, that's true. What you do does have a profound effect on those around you. And whether it's be providing for your family, that sense of purpose, that, you know, well-being, and just the relationships that we have at work are so very, very important. I have the privilege of being a second career pastor, and I have the good fortune to have worked for a great company who still invites me to come back to their Christmas party. Imagine that. Every year. And it's not because I'm doing anything for them. I'm not doing any work for Two Wire Electric anymore. But it's those relationships that I had in work that were so important. And indeed, it's like just a big reunion every time I go back. I don't do it every year, but when I do, I just love reconnecting with people. And if you think about it, if you understand or you know someone, that oftentimes when we retire, which we think is the greatest thing ever, and, you know, in 15 or so years, I wouldn't mind giving it a shot, but if we lose our work, sometimes what do we also lose? We feel like we've lost our purpose. We feel like sometimes that we've lost more than just a paycheck or a job, but sometimes it feels like, no, we lost even our reason for being. That's what work oftentimes means to us. We are doing a series throughout Lent called Cross-Examined. We've looked at the flesh. We've looked at the law. We've looked at wisdom. Today we're looking at works, and next week we're going to look at glory. And we're looking at the way that our idea of these things, whether it be the flesh or the law or wisdom or works or glory, is transformed by the cross of Jesus Christ. That our looking at those things, and we see them and we have an idea or a concept of what they're like, but yet the truth of them is revealed in the cross of Jesus. Work. Now, work is something that is from the very beginning. And God said, "Let there be light," and there was light. And then you have this period of 6 days of God working. He is at work creating. And he looks on his creation and says, you know, that's really good. And he decides to take a break on the seventh day. Work, if you go back and you look in the Genesis account, was not something that came as a result of the fall. No, work was there from the very beginning. What was Adam doing? Well, God was bringing to Adam, he was bringing the animals to be named. There was this garden, and if you have a garden, you know that a garden is indeed work. There are things that have to be done, and if you're doing it, just do this as a hobby, if it's something you enjoy, that's good work. It's great. It's wonderful to have. But then, well, our work can take a different tune. If you move forward in the story of the children of Israel, they are enslaved for 400 years, and for 400 years, what did they do nonstop? They work. And sometimes this is what our work feels like, doesn't it? It sometimes feels like it is nonstop and it's never ending. And God help you if you have a workaholic for a boss. I'm just saying. It's because the work never ceases. The work continues. It never ends. And what was one of the glorious things of the Exodus was, well, they were given an opportunity not to work. God gives his Ten Commandments. He gives these commandments, and he talks about honoring the Sabbath day and keep it holy. And then he goes on to explain what we are not to do on the Sabbath. It's to be a day where we don't work. And therein lies one of the issues that we have, is that we think that those works sometimes define our religious experience. That's what we look at. And if you think of the term works, you might have immediately gone to the things that you do or you don't do. You might have gone to those 613 laws that are spelled out in the Torah. You might think of plenty of other works. And you might even think that that's what defines your life as a follower of Jesus. I've been asked a question several times over the last year or so to tell a story. Now, the story is really not much of a story. It's a story about there's a little hole in my ear, and how did that get there? Most of you have probably not looked closely enough to notice that. Embra, I put in a diamond stud in there last night. The hole is still open, but I really thought that, you know, Steve McAlealy might can get away with a ponytail, but I'm not so sure I can get away with an earring. This is a part of my history. It's a part of my story. Now, I don't want to go too far off into this other than to say that I was a rather rebellious adolescent. My work was working contrary to God, primarily in many ways because that really irritated my parents, but also because of some bad experiences that I had had in the church, some hurts that I had experienced, and really wanted me to push and to get as far away from God as possible. Now, I don't want to give too much glory to that time because it certainly stole far more than it ever gave. I could tell you about the substances that I abused and the abuse that I subjected my own body to in other ways, but there is nothing good that comes from that. But I can also tell you that there was a time that came in my early 20s, I was 20, when I changed. My life changed. Now, part of it is because of those things that I was doing that, my schoolwork suffered tremendously. They tell me I had a great time at Mississippi State, at least that second semester. I don't remember most of it, honestly. But my dad had very clear words for me: come home and get a job. And in that summer, in that time of working, in that time of being a failure, having dropped out of college, having, really nothing to show for it, And I'm back to, well, working construction, doing, which I love, by the way. You can actually see what you've done at the end of the day. It's pretty nice, isn't it, Owen? I mean, there's some accomplishment in that work. But it wasn't my calling. It wasn't what I was supposed to. In fact, I had no idea what I was supposed to do. I was invited to this different church. It was an Assemblies of God church. And this was a different group of people. This was a very loving group of people. And what I did was I dove headlong into that community, and I dove headlong also into works. I was at every Bible study. I was at every time there was a church service. I was going to different churches. If there was a Baptist church that was having a service at a time that I wasn't going to another service, I would go there. If there was a Presbyterian church, you're not going to believe this, Mary, but if there was a Presbyterian church that had a service at a different time, I would go there. I was there. I was putting, well, I put 40,000 miles a year on my car driving back and forth to Jackson, basically. Every church service I would go to, back and forth from Brandon to Jackson. But do you hear the problem? It was works. I was still trying to save myself. And this is what Paul is talking to us about. He is saying to us very clearly that we cannot save ourselves. He says, you were dead through the trespasses and sins in which you once lived, following the course of this world. Okay, that's prior to that going to church and being all fired up and excited about that. Following the ruler of the power of the air, the spirit that is now at work among those who are disobedient. All of us once lived among them in the passions of our flesh, following the desires of flesh and senses, and we were by nature children of wrath like everybody else. And you know, we look at other people and you look at other people and you go, what are they thinking? Do you see? I mean, can't you see what you're doing to yourself? But when we do that, we're continuing in that children of wrath mentality. You see, we're shifting from one frame of works and one thing that we're doing into something else. We're shifting into this, well, I'm going to follow after whatever my passions, whatever way it leads, that's which way I'm going to go. We shift from following after that. I'm going to have to move the camera because I'm moving around. We shift from that to now, well, I'm going to do everything that's right. And we're failing again because we're saying, I'm going to do. I'm going to work. But it doesn't work, does it? Okay, I'm breaking protocol. I'm backing up. I'm sorry. I've had my first round vaccine, I promise. Got the second yesterday. That's why I'm kind of not feeling too good up here. But anyhow, so we have worked, we have continued to work, but we were still dead. We were still dead. It was the place that I had to come to and say, Jesus, I can't do this anymore. No matter how much I do, I still feel just as empty and just as lost as I ever was before. No matter how many times and how many services I go to, I'm still just, well, I'm no better off. I didn't understand this. Self-righteousness is just as much a sin as licentiousness. Self-righteousness, trying to make ourselves holy, has as many pitfalls as just following after the world. Now, the difference is people look at you and go, wow, that's a really good person. They're really great. Don't you see they're there? They're in church every time the doors are open. They signed up for the service at 8:45 on Sunday morning, and they actually showed up. We would look at the empty pews and go, or chairs, and go, well, who was supposed to be there? Somebody didn't show up. We're back to works. We're back to trying to justify ourselves. And Paul says we can't do that. It is by grace that you have been saved. A young man came up to Jesus and said, "Lord, what must I do to inherit eternal life?" Jesus says to him, "Well, I mean, you know the law. You know that there are things that you're supposed to do and things you're not supposed to do." He says, "Well, yeah, I've done all that." "Okay. Well, just sell everything you have and give that money to the poor and then come follow me." Well, now the works get really difficult, don't they? And you get really quiet. Now the works become exceedingly challenging. Well, is that what we have to do? Are we still back to the place of there's something that I have to do in order to be saved? Are we still in a place that, okay, here's a list I have to follow? Well, the answer is no, and the answer is yes. You see, we're not saved by our works, but we are saved to good works. Did you hear what Paul said? "For by grace you have been saved through faith, and this is not your own doing. It is the gift of God, not the result of works, so that no one may boast. For we are what he has made us." Did you hear the lyrics of the song, "I am who you say I am"? We are what he has made us, created in Christ Jesus for good. Thank you, Ember. Created in Christ Jesus for good. Created in Christ Jesus for good. Yes. It doesn't save us, but that which is God has prepared beforehand to be our way of life. Jesus said to his disciples after they had come back and they had been going out and casting out demons, they had been healing the sick, they had been proclaiming good news to the poor. And Jesus said, "I saw Satan falling like lightning to the earth." They were engaged in the good works of God. And it was defeating the very things that Satan doesn't want. It was defeating the purposes of Satan. I love this little line in the Screwtape Letters. You know this work by C.S. Lewis, where you have Screwtape who's saying to Wormwood, talking to him, he's an over-demon talking to a lesser demon. The enemy here is God. "You must have often wondered why the enemy does not make more use of his power to be sensibly present to human souls in any degree he chooses and in any moment." He's saying, you must have wondered why God doesn't just show up. Have you ever asked that question? Why doesn't God just show up? That's what we wanted when we were in college, when we were trying to find a mate. Why doesn't God just give us a flashing neon sign? That's what we'd like to have. This is the one, her, right here. That's it. Why doesn't the enemy make use of that power? "But you now see that the irresistible and the indisputable are the two weapons which the very nature of his scheme forbids him to use. Merely to override a human will would be for him useless. He cannot ravish, he can only woo." And he goes on to say, "He cannot tempt to virtue as we do to vice. He wants them to learn to walk and must therefore take away his hand. Our cause is never," listen to this, "our cause is never more in danger than when a human, no longer desiring but still intending to do our enemy's will, looks round upon a universe from which every trace of him seems to have vanished and asks why he has been forsaken and still obeys." In other words, looks around, sees no evidence for God's presence, wonders, Lord, where are you? And yet still does the work. It's some of the hardest things for us to do. We're so used to being driven by our feelings and what we desire and the things that we want. And so when it doesn't feel good, when we don't feel right, then we want to say, God, where are you? But yet there's the times when we still work. What does that work look like? Well, ultimately, it looks like Jesus hanging on the cross. Ultimately, it looks like self-sacrificial love for others. Hear the good news, though. Jesus, hanging on the cross, just before giving up his last, as the gospel writers say, has this statement: it is finished. It is finished. The work is done. The salvation has been sealed. There's nothing you can do to add to that work. There's nothing you can do to take away from it except not receiving it, not accepting it. Now, we'd be tempted, perhaps, to say, well, now it doesn't matter. But of course, we'd be wrong, wouldn't we? Because that's not the end of the story. We would be wrong if we said, well, Jesus died on the cross and he said, it is finished, so my work here on earth is done. And yet, no. Your striving for connection with God is done. But your work has just begun. What keeps us from being engaged in the work that God has for us? Well, there's one word that comes to mind, and that's shame. We've so convinced ourselves that it is our righteousness that matters, that when we sin, when we fall short, when we miss the mark, then instead of running back to God and saying, Lord, help me, God, forgive me, we say, well, God doesn't love me anymore. We live in shame. Then who's winning? The enemy is winning. It is finished. If that wasn't true, would Jesus have restored Peter after Peter had denied Jesus, swearing, I do not know the man? Of course not, but he did. And then he gives us a new work. He tells us now, go therefore and make disciples of all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit, and teaching them to obey everything that I have commanded you. And remember, I am with you always, even to the end of the age. I'm going to ask the band to come back, and as we come to a place now, as we close, what is your hope resting on? Is it resting on your work, or is it resting on the work of Jesus? Is your hope that you're a good person and that you're here and that you're regularly a part of the church activities? Or is it that Jesus said, on your behalf, it is finished? Is your hope that, well, I'm going to be a part of this ministry and that ministry, and I'm going to go here and I'm going to do this and I'm going to do that? Or is it that Well, there's one who says that you're my child and I love you. Yes, we are called to do good works. We are commanded to go out and to make disciples. But that's not where our hope rests. That 20-year-old hadn't figured that out yet, Helena. And at 49, I think I'm still trying to figure it out. But it's the work of Jesus on our behalf, so that then we can be his church, engaged fully, without shame, in his good works. Let's pray. Lord Jesus, here we are. We have no hope apart from you. It is only in you and through you that we can be saved. It is your gift to us. And yet you've called us as a redeemed, as a forgiven people, to embrace that forgiveness and then to engage in your work in the world, in our community, in our homes, in our church. Oh God, set us free from our own righteousness. Help us to walk and to live in your righteousness, that we might be your church. Amen.
Ephesians 2 and 8 through 10 tells us that by grace we have been saved, and it is by nothing we've done ourselves. Not any works of our own, but we are God's handiwork, created in Jesus Christ to do good works. With this in mind, let us be comforted in knowing that God takes what is. He takes us and makes us beautiful. Only God alone has the power to redeem.
We're restored forevermore.
Let's go to the Lord together in prayer. Oh God, this morning we have been reminded that you are bringing about something new in and through each one of us. God, as we're here in this space gathered, and Lord, wherever we are gathered today, whether it's at home or if it's here in this space, that we've gotten to hear the words of promise and of hope. Lord, you have said over and over again, and we see it in the scriptures, that you are bringing about a work that will make the ears of those who hear it tingle. And God, you are continuing to do that work through us now, today. And God, we thank you that the work is a gift. And Lord, that ultimately this work is done through you. Because God, through the words, it is finished. We can find our peace, our hope, and our joy. Lord, in a year as we reflect back on this past year of our lives, it has been filled with brokenness, despair even, and heaviness. But Lord, we thank you that today we can trust that you have seen those things, you have felt the needs of our hearts, and that God, you have restored the things that are broken. God, you are the redeemer of time. You live and move and operate beyond our time and our understanding. And Lord, we ask that you continue to soften our hearts to the reality of who you are and your will for our lives. God, that you love us. And as we pause and reflect on the things that you are saying to us today, Jesus, what are you saying to us today? Let us remember, God, that we are treasured deeply, that each one of us is treasured by you. God, we thank you for that gift. Lord, be with those who are sick and hurting. There is great need in our community even now. And Lord, forgive us when we have erred and strayed from your ways like lost sheep. God, bring us back to you. Move us into a posture of worship and possibility where we see you fully. God, we thank you, we worship you, we honor you today. It's in the name of the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit we pray. Amen. And now, as forgiven and reconciled people of God, let us offer our gifts to God and to one another. So if you're here in this space, you'll have a chance to give in the baskets at the door when you leave today, so don't feel like you need to get up now. But you also can go online and give that way, or via mail or text. You know the drill at this point. But again, thank you for worshiping with us today, and let us continue to do that now.
Why don't you stand with us and let's sing this together.
Oh, I've heard a thousand stories of what they think you're like, and I've heard the tender whisper of the dead of night, and tell that you're pleased in to I am.
To remind you before the benediction that when we finish the benediction, you may remain standing or you can sit down and wait for the ushers. Y'all are going to come get them out and usher them out, right? Yes, they're going to do that. So wait for that. But now receive the benediction. Now to him who by the power at work within us is able to accomplish abundantly far more than we all can ask or imagine. To him be glory in the church and in Christ Jesus to all generations, forever and ever. Amen.
Yes, you are.